Okay, I am here today. I'm very excited. I'm here with my very close friend, Dean Bull. And we're going to be talking about a number of things, trees, rocks. You might hear a pun or two. It's always possible with Dean. I got to say, Dean is, I met Dean, I think it was probably about maybe 1989, 1990. He showed up in Ann Arbor where I was living at the time. And I knew within minutes of meeting him that we would become lifelong friends, which we have. And so I'm really excited to be here. Dean has won numerous awards for his bonsai. He's been very active in different bonsai organizations, and I'm not going to try to repeat his resume because it's like 10 pages long. But anyway, I really enjoy being with Dean. He has taken care of my bonsai for 7 or 8 years. 6 years, he's saying. Yeah. So we have a friendship and a working relationship. And for me, one of the most important things about bonsai is sharing. And sharing your trees, for example, exhibiting them, that's one way of sharing, and that's really great. But Dean is one of a few people that I like to spend a lot of time with actually doing bonsai. And that's a kind of sharing too. We share knowledge. We share elbow grease, and it's just a really great situation. So today you are going to meet one of the most amazing horologists I've ever met.
The lesson there is that obsessive compulsive disorder, which is something that you have to have in order to be doing bonsai, can be applied to many things like rocks and collecting them and repairing clocks. It works for that too. The trick is you can't take the medication. If you take the medication, you're just not out of control.
Oh, this one sprung a leak.
And what are those for?
Okay, these 3 55-gallon barrels I put in here in the fall, fill them with rainwater, and they freeze up over the winter, and then this ends up being a great big beer cooler to keep the deciduous trees held back as much as possible for as long as possible, so that when the weather warms up, it is more likely to stay warm for them. Mm-hmm. What I don't want is for the buds to come out and start pushing leaves, and then we have a cold snap where it's down to 0 degrees, which is perfectly legal in Michigan, even in April or May. So we've got a plan B here to keep them viable.
And why do you have a movie poster in with your cold storage?
That's a long story. Back in 2009, I was contacted by the people who were producing this movie called Hide Away. The lead actress in the movie, her name is Ayelet Zurer. She was born and raised in Tel Aviv, Israel. And she plays the part of a waitress in a cafe who also loves bonsai trees, but they didn't have any trees and she didn't know what to do with them. So they hired me as a consultant so that I could show her what to do with some trees. And so 4 of them actually are in the movie, and I'm in the credits, and it was a wonderful experience. But yeah, these are all fossils. Almost all of them are fossils. So most of them came from over on Lake Huron near Alpena. And what's particularly fun about rock collecting is the fact that they end up having these fractal patterns in them. And fractal patterns are beautiful. We try to accomplish that with the bonsai art too. And so these guys just lend themselves very nicely to multiple obsessions.
The very first time I heard the word bonsai was a friend of mine named Gary Bregg. He used the word. He had a couple of really tiny little trees that he was growing on this kitchen sink, and he called them bonsai, and I picked up the term from him, and one thing led to another. This was probably 1970 when I first learned about it. And I was always fascinated with the idea of doing bonsai, but I never got around to it until I was looking at within a few years of having an empty nest. And, you know, when you're raising children and buying braces and automobiles and all of the other, you know, clarinet lessons and all that stuff, it's hard to take up a hobby for yourself. Mm-hmm. But once my youngest daughter was in high school, and that means it was about 1988, 89, in there that I collected my first tree. And it's sitting over there. We'll look at that later if you want to. Anyway, I've always been fascinated with trees. As a kid, my dad, before I was even born, had planted some, well, there's a genetic factor there too, I guess. He had planted about 1,000 Colorado blue spruce trees from seed, and then had planted them out after they, you know, got up this tall. And as I grew up, so did the trees, and we spent basically every Saturday during every month with an R in it, moving trees and selling them. And he got a nurseryman's license and had them inspected, and we, you know, we did it right. But there's a lot of blue spruce trees around the state of Michigan that that we got started.
Wow.
Back in those days, you couldn't find a book on bonsai. You couldn't find a magazine on bonsai. And so it was kind of meager pickings to try to learn.
You spent a lot of time with Eunice, not just here, but collecting and doing other things, I think.
Oh, yeah. She asked me, just after we started the club in 1990, she said, do you have any plans for collecting trees this fall? And I said, well, actually, I kind of do. I said there was a bunch of white cedars growing out of stumps and so on, and that was kind of a thing I was into at the moment. And she said, well, how about I go with you? I said, okay. And Eunice was this huge lady about this tall and just a lovely person. She was probably 65 years old at the time. And she had her own chest waders. And I said, yeah, come on. So we took my little rowboat and her chest waders and my chest waders, and we went collecting trees. We spent, I don't know how many hours, cutting white cedars from that were growing out of rotted stumps and bringing them back to my house. We had to make two trips because we had so many that we couldn't haul them all in one trip. And some of the trees, well, some of them are here. Some of them belong to other people in the club. They've gone everywhere. So yeah, that was the very beginnings of it.
I mean, what did you do in Northern Michigan with almost no bonsai going on? How did you increase your skills, and how did you build your bonsai practice?
I have Bruce Baker to thank for that, mostly. After we started the club in 1990. In 1991, August of 1991, Bruce came to one of our meetings to do a demo for us, and we'd never seen anybody do a bonsai demo, didn't know that was a thing. And I brought one of my white cedar trees that's sitting right over there, and you critiqued that tree. There was one of them that I had cut off of a rotted stump. And, you know, much of what you told me at that time got incorporated into the tree. And, and then, you know, of course, we became close friends, and I spent time with you in Ann Arbor at your shack down there, and you spent time up here, and you introduced me to Jack Weichel, who has become an integral part of my bonsai practice. I have traveled all over the country and to Japan with Jack Weichel, studying bonsai and sharing secrets and lies and all kinds of fun. We even shared a bottle of sake in Japan before we came back. It was our last night there.
You got Jack Weichel to drink alcohol?
He drank sake. And we got a little bit chuckly.
I'll bet.
Yeah,
I'll
yeah.
Bet.
He'll probably deny it, but it's true.
So I'm going to change the direction of the conversation a little bit. You are standing next to one of my favorite bonsai right now. And it's amazing because for years I wondered why you even had it. And why don't you tell me the story of this tree? This is amazing to me.
Well, gosh, I think it was 1993 that I bought a batch of Scotch pine seedlings from a nursery downstate. 50 of them was in a bundle about that big, so you know how big they are. This trunk is bigger than that 50-tree bundle was at
wow.
the time. And I had this piece of volcanic red rock in my backyard, and I was always fascinated with root over rock. And I knew it was going to take a long time, but I thought, you know, if you're in a hurry, what are you doing bonsai for, you know? And so I didn't know how to do it, so I just thought something up. which is the way I'll do a lot of things with bonsai. I took the rock and I draped the roots over it, and I used electrical tape to wrap around it to hold the roots to the rock, and I planted it right up to here. And I let it grow for probably, I don't know, 8 years.
You put it in
years.
A bucket or some kind of oversized
container? Yeah, just a big, it was probably a bussing tub that I drilled holes in the bottom of. That's one of the containers that I used back in those days for training trees. And then maybe after 8 years or 10 years, I took it out, unpotted it, and then buried it only up to here. Put it back in the tub for another 8 or 10 years. And then I excavated it down to here and then let it grow again. And if you look at the pictures of this tree, you'll find that Bruce had the right idea. You idiot, what are you spending time with this damn tree for? Well, it only took, do the math on that.
Took three people about 2 hours maybe to wire?
Oh yeah,
wire
it? 20 years to get it into a pot.
Oh yeah.
And then start training it. Well, two summers ago, Jerry Mislick, who you also introduced me to the same day that I met Jack Weigel, and he has become a close friend and a bonsai buddy and a mentor. Anyway, you and I and Jerry spent, I think, 3.5 hours 2 years ago training and wiring this tree. And if you look at the before and after pictures, it doesn't look like the same tree, does it?
It doesn't look like the same tree, and it doesn't look the same as any other pine tree that I'm familiar with. It's really got a unique shape, and I'm just, the rootage over that rock is something you really rarely see with pines.
And you can't fake that.
It
takes time, and that's the only thing you can do is give the tree the time and let the tree grow.
You know, one of the things that amazes me about you and amazes me about your bonsai is that you're pushing the envelope all the time. I mean, it's whether it's that tree that we talked about, the pine over the rock, which is something I'd never seen quite like that before, or now this composition, which I have to tell you, every time I look about or look at this or even think about it, I get a smile on my face. You want to talk about it? I mean, how did you even come up with this concept?
I'm not sure. I had the tree. The tree was given to me with another tree back in 2001. Anyway, I experimented with a number of different pots for it. I've always liked it. It was not trained in windswept style, but I was never happy with it because couldn't find the right pot. And the tree was kind of skanky and skinny and not really very impressive. So I've had the tree for 20 years. Also, this truck, when we moved to this house 20 years ago, this somehow ended up in my possession. And I don't even know who had it originally. It may have been in the previous house where we lived for 19 years. I think it was probably there. So I've had this truck for probably 40 years. And it was in my pole barn, and I was thinking about the tree, and I was down at the pole barn, and I saw the truck, and I thought, I wonder. And so one thing led to another, and it was last May, I think it was, when I first put these two things together. And I got the WikiLeaks in here and all of that. I fixed up the wheels so they can't roll and the dump truck can't dump.
And you explained to me the other day that this is actually a classical style.
Hopefully it will become one, yeah.
It's amazing. I'm going to get a little closer so we can
take a good look at this thing.
Well, you can imagine a bonsai exhibit that would be like those rolling car exhibits. Beautiful.
Maybe something from this side will give you the idea that it's just leaning.
Wow, that is crazy. And I want to show a little bit of the tree itself just because it has interest.
measures about 7 feet long if you follow the...
If you uncoil it?
Yeah,
if
you uncoil
it. Nice. Of all the trees in your collection, this is probably the one that I've thought the most about. It may not be my favorite, although it could easily be my favorite. It's one I've thought the most about, and it's the one we probably talked more about than any other tree.
Intriguing might be the right word. I don't know.
Intriguing?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, for those of you who didn't notice, that was a pun. So anyway, tell me about this tree. This is to me, this gives me both nightmares, and it also just gives me these incredible sensations of, wow, how could this possibly happen?
This tree was growing out of a rock situation. Everything from here down is roots, and most of it was out of the earth, okay? And this part down here was in the dirt. He used a crowbar to pull the rocks apart and pulled the tree out. And so I came up with this planting angle and the idea that the deadwood root would come out the front and be exposed in front of the pot. I made the pot. That's a subject of another thing, is my Barney Rubble pot. The only way you could make a mistake with this tree is to not try to move it forward. It's just way too compelling.
Yeah, it's amazing. Absolutely amazing.
It breaks all the rules. You won't find pictures of how to do this tree in a John Naka book or any place else. You're left to your own devices. And that's, to me, that is one of the challenges of bonsai, is to find something that nobody else in the whole world could possibly make anything out of, and then make something out of it, like the truck and the windswept tree.
And the pot, I'm going to try to get a close-up. The pot is unique, and there's only one place I know of in the universe where you can get these pots, and that's right here. You want to talk about that?
Well, you know, I've used, this is something called New York Multicolor. And New York Bluestone is something that I used 20 years ago when we first built a house to make a sidewalk. I've also used it even longer than that ago to make slabs for bonsai. I've got a larch forest and another larch that grows on a slab, and it's made out of this kind of rock. And I was toying with ideas for making pots out of slabs of porcelain, to have a potter make porcelain slabs with holes in them and then stitch them together with wire. And I tried to get that done, and it was never going to happen. And so I decided, well, what the hell have I got to lose? I'm going to go buy some rock and start. If you think I should put something behind this, I might be able to take some of these trees away from it.
No, it's not necessary for this.
Okay.
We will we'll show people what it looks like. Dean, what's the next stop for you in your bonsai? Where are you headed with it?
I'm focused on process. You know, everybody has these goals in mind, long-term goals, short-term goals, and all that. My goal is to enjoy the process, moment by moment. You only get one moment at a time anyway. So, you know, the future is kind of a figment of your imagination. And when I go to work on trees, I come out here in the morning and I think, okay, what have I got to do next? I got to prune that one. I got to repot this one at a different angle. Okay, what's the most important thing that I can do right now to maximize my time with my trees today, right here, right now. It always comes down to that moment that's in front of you. And I don't do a lot of thinking about the future beyond that. One of the things that I want to do is refine that Scotch pine the way you've suggested to me to do that. But I can't do that right now today. I got other things I've got to do. So that's on the back burner for the moment. But sooner or later, that's going to come to the top. And I'm going to say, okay, now's the time. I'm going to grab that tree and put it in front of a backdrop and start working on it.
And any, you know, I love that philosophy. I do. I love the fact that what you're talking about is being present with your trees.
Yeah.
And for me, that's a lot of it. I mean, it's a stress reliever.
Oh,
and
boy.
Don't you have another stress reliever phrase that you use? I remember there's kind of an inhaling and exhaling. You're inhaling something.
Oh,
and then
yeah. It's that breathing thing. There's this. You can find it on the internet if you Google something about guided meditation. And it's you breathe in. And when you breathe in peace, love, and joy. And you hold it for a moment, and then you let it out. And when you let it out, you let go of all bullshit. And you say, fuck that shit. And, boy, I'll tell you, I swear I have lowered my blood pressure by using that technique. But you've got to mean it. You've got to be sincere.